أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
ورسلا قد قصصناهم عليك من قبل ورسلا لم نقصصهم عليك.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. We are continuing in our series about the prophets, and we are still in our introductory lectures. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. One of the things I love about these series that Allah has blessed me to do is that we have no end time. There's no burden on finishing. And if we meander our way through, alhamdulillah, and we learn and benefit from each other, then inshallah ta'ala, time is on our side here. So we have plenty of introductory lectures before we move on to the stories of the actual prophets one by one. And today I'm going to continue from where we left off. In our last lecture, I was talking about some of what made the prophets human. And we talked about emotions, and we talked about anger, and we talked about forgetfulness, and eating, and drinking, and marrying, and siring children. All of this comes within the natural realm and territory of being human beings. And indeed, all of the prophets were humans. Now, the issue that really brings up the most controversy is the issue of the possibility of the prophets of Allah committing sins after their prophethood begins. As for before their prophethood begins, there's a little bit more leeway. That's okay, they might have done some things here and there, you know, before the prophethood began. But after the beginning of revelation, after Jibreel begins commencement of the wahi, and they get the upgraded status to become Nabi or to become Rasul, there is no question that they are now the holiest of the holy, and they are the best of the best. That's something there is no difference of opinion amongst all the people who say the kalima. The difference of opinion comes how holy and how blessed. They are the best of the best. Does that mean that they become absolutely sinless like the angels? Or can they do something that goes against the commandments of Allah and that would constitute basically a sin? Now again, we said so many times, there is no controversy or doubt that they are protected from certain things. Of them is lying, of them is tampering with the revelation, of them is ascribing something to Allah that is not true, of them is they themselves claiming to be, a'udhu billah, gods, of them is committing shirk, of them is even major sins. All of this is something there is no controversy over. The real controversy comes over what we call minor sins, what we call sagair. And the Quran mentions kaba'ir and sagair. Now before I get to the Islamic controversy, it is important, we're not going to go into a lot of detail, but nonetheless, it is important to realize that this is one of the unique aspects of our religion of Islam, in contradistinction to Judaism and Christianity. The way that the prophets are described in the biblical sources is something that Muslims are absolutely shocked at. They are appalled by. To be honest, the first time Muslims hear this, they cannot believe that these sources describe these holy men with the crimes that they ascribe them to. And we thank Allah we don't have to deal with that type of controversies of because if you're a believer of the Bible, if you're a Jewish or Christian person, you have to reconcile the prophetic image with what the Bible describes to them. From our perspective, there is no question that what is mentioned in the biblical sources is not true. It is a falsehood. It is something that has been invented by later humans and ascribed to the earlier prophets, and the prophets are not at all guilty of what has been ascribed to them. So for example, our mother Hawa is cursed in the Bible allegedly because she is the one who tempted, and because of her all women are accursed, and because of her and her sin the monthly cycle happens, and because of her and her sin there's going to be pangs every time the child delivers, every time a woman gives birth, excuse me. Those pangs should remind the lady apparently of what their mother Hawa did. And of course this is simply unfair, because Adam and Hawa both ate from the tree, and therefore in the Quran the blame is on the both of them. Hawa is not cursed and definitely not her daughters after her. In fact, if anyone, it is Adam who is reprimanded in the Quran. وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ. Adam disobeyed because he was the one who ate from the tree. So the point being, this notion of cursing Hawa, the divine curse on women, it is not found in the Quran. As well, one of the most heinous crimes is that which is mentioned. A number of prophets, a number of things are mentioned. I mean, some of them, for example, Noah or Nuh in Genesis 9, verses 20-23, that one of his children made fun of Nuh because allegedly, we don't believe this at all, and the prophets are free of this, he became so drunk that he exposed his nakedness to the people or to his children, and one of his sons, you know, mocked and whatnot, and because of this, he was cursed. Now, this curse also has a racial overtone, because according to the biblical legend, the son that was cursed became the father of one race, and that race that was used, these types of verses were used to justify slavery and whatnot. So again, we don't have anything to do with that tradition and this narrative. But this notion of one of the sons, you know, making fun of the nakedness of the father, of the awra of the father, is something not befitting the prophets, that they're lying drunk on the floor in this regard. In the book of Numbers, there is a story about, allegedly, we don't believe this, that Moses commanded his army to kill the Midianites, every single man, woman, children, and even babies. And when some children and women were spared, he became angry. And he said, why did you let them, you know, live? And he commanded that, you know, many of them be killed and the rest of them be taken as slaves. This is in Numbers chapter 31, verses 15-17. Perhaps the most disgusting, to be honest, and we don't believe this at all, and wallahi, we don't even like to mention these things, but because it is something that Muslims should know and be aware of, that our controversies in this regard are utterly trivial, very trivial. Is it a minor mistake? Is it a slip up? We don't have to deal with the baggage of the other traditions. Perhaps the most vulgar and hair-raising and gut-wrenching and disgusting accusation that is falsely ascribed to the prophets is in Genesis chapter 19, verses 31 onwards, in which أعوذ بالله, and I shudder to even say this and ask Allah's forgiveness to even say this, but this is for educational purposes, and we're allowed to mention shaitan and to mention the tactics of shaitan and the evil of shaitan to warn people against him, not to support. And so when we say these types of things, it is to educate so that we can thank Allah for having guided us to what we believe. But in this chapter, Genesis chapter 19, verses 30 onwards, that when Lut alayhi salam allegedly was saved from his people, the only people apparently in that region were him and his two daughters. And his two daughters decided that, أعوذ بالله, they wanted to have intercourse, but there is no man in sight. And so they made their father drunk, and each one of them took turns, أعوذ بالله, in this insensual relationship. And they gave birth as a result of this, and the children from this insensuous relationship became the fathers of other tribes and nations. This is what the book of Genesis says, chapter 19. And again, there is no question that these are fabrications, that these are lies against these noble prophets. How can, well, if anybody did this in a neighborhood, we would kick him out of the neighborhood. How can you expect a pious person, much less a prophet, much less the Prophet Lut alayhi salam, who preached morality his entire life and who stood as a figure against hedonism and against the tyrannies of moral injustice that were taking place. Now you're going to accuse him, a'udhu billah, of getting drunk, and then his own daughters, a'udhu billah, doing this evil deed, and then children being born, and these children then becoming the fathers of other nations. This is simply not true at all. In 2 Samuel 11 onwards, and 2 Samuel has a number of you know, these types of accusations, but David, Dawood alayhi salam, is falsely accused of multiple acts of debauchery, of gazing upon a naked woman with lust, and then of wanting to be with her, and then of seducing, and then she was a married lady, and that didn't stop him apparently. And then he wanted to have more of her, then he sends her husband into battle so that the husband is killed, so that he can then acquire this lady. Again, this is simply impossible. This is stuff that you make dramas out of. It is not the lives of the prophets of Allah that they go kill people because they want their wives. It doesn't work that way. Also, Sulaiman in 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 3 to 10, that according to this narrative, which is completely false, and the Quran frees Sulaiman, وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانُ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا. This is the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is applicable to, and we'll come to it inshallah ta'ala, it is negating what the Bible ascribes to Sulaiman. The Bible ascribed blatant shirk and kufr to Sulaiman. The Bible says that Solomon worshipped false gods because he wanted to please his wives. So his wives were pagans, and a number of them had false gods, and so to basically be romantic with his wives, he worshipped their false gods. And shirk is the worst sin. No righteous person commits shirk. How do you expect a prophet to do this? But this is what is mentioned in the Bible, that Solomon worshipped Milcom, the god of the Ammonites, and he built a temple for Chemosh, the idol of the Moabites, and he built a temple for Molech or Molech, the idol of the Ammonites people, and he did this for all of his other wives from all of the other civilizations, that he built temples with their idols, and he allowed his wives to worship, and he himself worshipped there as well. And according to this, the verse, the Lord commanded Solomon not to follow other gods, but Solomon did not follow the command of God. I.e., in this section, we don't believe this at all, Allah says to Sulaiman, don't worship other gods. And Sulaiman disobeys this commandment and he worships the false gods. Again, we simply cannot believe this at all. And in 2 Samuel as well, the brothers of Sulaiman, the sons of David, one of them commits incest with his sister. Another one rapes hundreds of women or dozens of women one night, and everybody's around the tent knowing that this is happening and encouraging. I mean, this is what you write to Hollywood or dramas or something out of. This is not the lives of the prophets or the sons of the prophets doing, or the brothers of the prophets or the families of the prophets. Impossible that this type of narrative is something that we can believe in. And in our tradition, alhamdulillah thumma alhamdulillah, no group of Islam, not Sunnis, not Shias, not Ibadis, not Mu'tazilis, not Zaydis, not Ismailis, no group at all that claims to be Muslim, no group affirms that the prophets can do such heinous and evil and bizarre and immoral deeds. It is impossible for the prophets of Allah to act in such a manner, because acting in such a manner not just taints, it destroys their claims of being prophets of Allah and of being the righteous people. So we can dismiss this type of narrative. However, we have to deal with another set of issues which seems utterly trivial in light of the biblical narrative. Alhamdulillah for that, we thank Allah. But now we have to get into the internal. What do our scholars differ over? That, what are the prophets protected from after prophethood begins? Now, I was wondering how much detail should I go into, and I know I'll disappoint some of you when I say I'm not going to go into that much detail, because that would really make this a very, very technical and advanced lecture. We'd have to go into the various strands even within Sunni Islam, because for those advanced students, you are well aware that even Sunnism has multiple strands and controversies within it, and this is not the time or place to get into all of them. So I have decided to basically cut it down. As I have said multiple times, this is a intermediate lecture overall, and at some times we get advanced, but overall it inshallah never goes beneath intermediate to advanced. And this is also, I went down to the intermediate to go into this controversy, because this is a controversy that one could easily, no exaggeration, spend easily a few hours discussing the various positions and the evidences and whatnot. So we're simply going to summarize. There are actually over 7 positions within the Ummah over what type of protection is given to the prophets after the prophets begin their prophethood, right? What is the ismah? What is the infallibility that is bestowed upon them? To what extent are they infallible? And we will basically mention 2 opinions with a tacked on 3rd one, which is not within Sunni Islam, and it is not something we're going to discuss too much. So there are 2 opinions, and of course there are many more than these. I mean, you do have the bizarre theologians of other groups, that maybe 1 or 2 of the Kharijites or whatnot, they said that prophets are completely normal, just like anybody else, and they can even commit a major sins. But that's no mainstream position, no accepted denomination that became widespread. You had pockets here and there of small individuals. When I should say small individual, I mean solitary is what I meant. Solitary individuals who might have had bizarre interpretations, but in reality, no mainstream movement in the past or in the present says that it is possible for the prophets to commit major sins, much less shirk and kufr, much less lying about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, the two main issues or positions that we are interested in is, can they commit minor sins or not? Can they commit minor sins or not? And the position that I will advocate, and we have to understand before I even advocate the position, see, this topic, a lot of people, now listen to me carefully, a lot of people find it difficult to discuss this topic in an academic manner. And one's emotions clouds the evidences. And one's suppositions of how it should be clashes with the realities of how it really is. Because it is human nature to aggrandize those whom we love. It is human nature to put people whom we respect on a pedestal that is higher than what they actually deserve. And this is one of the tendencies of human beings, that they make somebody who is beloved to them, holy to them, someone that they admire, they put him on a much, much higher level, and then they find out he's not to that level, and that really destroys their myth. Now, this becomes easier when the person you admire is no longer living, and you can put them higher and higher and higher. And that is why, and I've said this in my seerah classes on various occasions, and I've said this in other places as well, that some of the understandings that later Muslim theologians and aqidah and mystics had about the Prophet ﷺ, we do not even find them amongst the Sahaba. That they understood his humanity, the claim that he's not human, the claim that he doesn't eat, the claim that he does not emit a shadow, for example. It is found in some medieval books that some of these theologians said the Prophet ﷺ does not have a shadow. Okay, that is found. But the Sahaba never said this. In fact, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and others would hold something to protect the sun from him and other things. So, when you're living with somebody, you can see his humanity. The Sahaba, by virtue of the fact that they're living with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these notions of him being superhuman did not come to them. They realized he's fully human and he's the best human being. So the Sahaba had a different tasawwur than some of the later strands of Islam who could easily then construct an image that is not in conformance with reality. And this is demonstrated in this topic as well. And so this topic of the isma of the prophets is one that I have to tread very, very carefully, because it is so easy for somebody to misunderstand or misinterpret and then claim that this is a disrespect for the prophets. But it is not a disrespect when the person has raised the prophets to the level of superhuman, and then we mention that the prophets are actually humans. In that person's mind, it is disrespect. But Allah says, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ, I'm a human being, flesh and blood. They ate, they drank, they walked in the سُوقِ يَأْكُلُونَ يَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ, they're walking in the سُوقِ and bazaars. And Allah Azza wa Jal negates the extremism of the Christians by saying that both Maryam and Isa would eat food. كَانَ يَأْكُلَانِ الطَّعَامِ. And when you eat, then the notion or the concept of, well, if you eat something, then it has to go somewhere. And Allah is indicating, how could an entity that relies on food and then must relieve itself be worthy of worship? But there are people who actually believe that the prophets do not eat and drink, or the prophets do not relieve themselves. And this is something that goes against, Sahih Bukhari mentions that the Prophet would, that the adab of wudu, the adab of relieving oneself, it is mentioned. Human beings are there. Now, if somebody has said that the Prophet does not eat or drink and does not relieve oneself, then you quote to him, well, all the prophets do that. Then he says, this is denigrating, this is insulting the maqam of the Prophet. We say, you're the one that has constructed the false image of what the prophets should be, what the prophets should be like. When we show you what they really are, they are the best of the best. There is no controversy over this, but in the best of the best, they still have their humanity. So, with all of this disclaimer, and Allah Azza wa Jalla help us, because again, this is such an emotional topic. But nonetheless, this is not my opinion, dear brothers and sisters. These are the opinions of giants on both sides. We respect them, and I'll mention names here. Great ulama on both sides. And these ulama, they disagreed with one another without accusation. Subhanallah. This shows you they understood. Great ulama on both sides of the opinion, and they understood that the other side has an opinion that they don't have, and there was no accusations of disrespect, no accusations of denigrating the status of the Prophet ﷺ, no accusation of Gustakhi Rasul or whatever. All of this was absent because they had fiqh of the deen and maturity and knowledge. And even if each group differed, they gave respect to the other. Now, with this, all of this long disclaimer, we state that the position that I'm advocating, which is the position of many have said the majority, but then the other school also said they have the majority, is that it is impossible for the prophets to commit major sins, much less kufr and shirk. Impossible. It is also impossible for the prophets to commit unbecoming sins, sins that are demeaning, sins that are despicable in the eyes of the masses. However, it is possible for them to slip into a mistake that is other than this, with the condition that it is a one-off mistake. They do it once and they repent, and the mistake affects them positively so that they become better people as a result. And so they become role models for us in their repentance. And they become role models for us in that this mistake causes them to be better than they were before. And so the mistakes or the sins of the prophets are minor, one-off, and they repent, and their repentance is our role model, and they become better after their repentance. This is the position that not I am advocating, but many scholars of Sunni Islam, they advocated, and many of them said this is the majority position, and I will quote you names inshallah soon as well. Now, what are the evidences for this? Frankly, the evidences for this are simply too numerous and too obvious. And that is why it is a default position. And that is why if you do not teach a Muslim constructed theology and you ask him to read the Quran, and then you ask him some simple questions, they will understand what I'm about to say, because they have not been taught to rethink through the evidences in a different manner. And the most obvious example that every Muslim knows, and if they don't study a later theological interpretation or school, and they simply read the Quran, they know it because the Quran says so, is our father Adam alayhi salam. Our father Adam alayhi salam. This is the most obvious evidence. And as I said, you don't need to reinterpret anything. It is very clear that Allah Azza wa Jal said to Adam, do not eat of this tree. This is the commandment to you. And a commandment of a prohibition implies that it is haram. When Allah says don't, then it implies tahreem, it is haram. And something that is haram is a sin to do. And that is why shaytan seduced them, beguiled them. فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُمَ الشَّيْطَانِ. If it was halal to eat from the tree, if it was not a sin to eat from the tree, shaytan does not have to do waswas. And shaytan enticed them. And shaytan said, this is going to cause you to live forever. And so what did Allah say? فَأَكَلَا مِنْهَا فَبَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا. When they ate from the tree, the clothes that they wore went off there, because they're living in Jannah and those clothes are not worthy now. So the fact that the clothes went off is an indication they did something they should not have done. And then Allah says in the Quran as well, وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى. This is as explicit as you can possibly do. وَعَصَى آدَمُ. Adam disobeyed his Lord, and so he went astray. You cannot be more explicit than this. Isyan is a sin. This is a sin. You disobey. You shouldn't have done it. Our father Adam did it, and he becomes a role model for us in what he did after. Not in the sin, but in the repentance of the sin. وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى ثُمَّ جَتَبَاهُ رَبُّهُ. Then his Lord chose him. فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. And accepted his repentance. If he didn't do a sin, there was no repentance to accept. If he didn't do a sin, he wouldn't have gone ghawa, misguided. If he didn't do a sin, Allah wouldn't say, I chose him back, fashtabahu, because he was unchosen for a while, and then he became chosen, wahada, and he was guided again. So the fact that Allah guided him again indicates for a while he was not upon that guidance. He did something he should not have done. And this is something, again, explicit in the hadith as well. that Musa alayhi salam meets Adam in the afterlife, and Musa says that, are you the one who caused all of mankind to be expelled from Jannah? Bidhanbika, because of your sin. Because of your sin caused us to be expelled from Jannah. This hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. It's the most authentic level. And Musa responds, or Adam responds that, it's not my fault that this was decreed that we're going to be on earth even before I was created. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Adam won the argument, Adam won the argument. Fahajja Adam Musa, Adam won over Musa, Adam won over Musa. So this is very explicit. Also, what did Adam do after he was expelled from Jannah? Qala rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. Every single phrase in this dua of Adam indicates what Adam did was a sin. Again, why am I being so explicit? Because it is obvious to 99% of you. I guarantee you that every one of you who has not studied a later theological school, that when you read the Quran, this is what you will understand, because it is self-evident. So why am I keep on stressing the point? Because, as I will mention, another very great school, we respect their ulama and their great people and whatnot, but they said that no prophets can ever commit any type of sin. They are sinless. And then, of course, what do you do with all of these evidences? Now you have to go and redo and reinterpret and change, or not change, astaghfirullah, I mean here, give a couching of what actually happened so that you can free yourself of the obvious, which is, وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. We have wronged ourselves. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا, if you don't forgive us because they have committed a sin. وَتَرْحَمْنَا, and have mercy on us because the mercy has been lifted us. لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ, we are going to be of those who are lost and destroyed because they have done something they should not have done. So again, it is self-evident that what Adam did was something that we call a sin. Allah said, don't do it, and he did it. Now, the type of sin that he did, we understand it as human beings. It wasn't a sin that is disgusting like the Bible says of incest and murder and whatnot. It's everybody wants to live longer. And we understand that it's a natural desire. I mean, this type of sin, we can relate to it. That's the point. The sins of the prophets are actually minor infractions, one-off. He didn't do it again. The repentance comes immediately. He becomes a role model for our repentance, and we can relate to that sin. It's a sin that it's human nature to have, that we want to live better lives and comfortable lives and live longer. We don't want to die early. So it's a something that we can sympathize with, and then we realize our father Adam did something he shouldn't have done, and he becomes a role model in his repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Nuh alayhi salam, in the Quran it is very explicit, and Allah mentions the story. Alhamdulillah. Allah mentions this story to tell us the reality of what happened. That Allah says to Nuh very explicitly that, وَلَا تُخَاطِبْنِي فِي الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِنَّهُمْ مُغْرَقُونَ. Do not speak to me about those who have done wrong and have worshipped the false gods. They haven't accepted your faith, our faith. Do not even speak to me about them. They are going to be drowned. They're going to not survive the flood. And then Nuh's son did not accept the faith. Nuh's son was still worshipping the idols of the ancestors. And we all know the story that when the water became higher and higher, وَنَادَى نُوحٌ إِبْنَهُ وَكَانَ فِي مَعْزِلٍ. Nuh was away from the boat. He was not there. And Nuh called out to his son, يَا بُنَيْ, my dear son, إِرْكَبْ مَعَنَا, come on the boat with us, right? And don't be amongst the people who have done wrong. And the son said, قَالَ سَآوِي إِلَى جَبَلٍ يَعْصِمُنِي مِنَ الْمَاءِ. He said, I'm going to climb up to a mountain, and the mountain will save me from this flood. قَالَ لَا عَاصِمَ الْيَوْمَ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمٍ. And Nuh said, no one can protect you from Allah's command except Allah himself if he wants to have mercy on you. You're not going to be saved. Then, once Nuh sees his son die, his son is drowning, and his son is taken, what does Nuh say? Nuh says, oh my Lord, you said to me you would save my family. وَإِنَّ بْنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي, and this son of mine is from my family. And your promise is always true. And Allah says, يَا نُوح إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ. you have done a deed that is not good. I told you, don't speak to me about those people who have rejected. And you knew these were the rules. I said to you, and now you come to me just because he's your son and you argue with me. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنِّي أَعِذُكَ أَن تَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِكَ أَنْ أَسْأَلَكَ مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِهِ عِلْمٍ وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لِي وَتَرْحَمْنِي أَكُنْ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ Nuh understands his love for his son got the better of him. And see again, the sins of the prophets we can relate to. It's a tragedy that strikes a chord in every human being. That here you have your son, here you have the commandments of Allah, and there's this tension, and Allah has said, do not do this. And Nuh does it because there's a love for the son. And then Nuh realizes, I should not have done this. And so even Nuh says, oh my Lord, I have committed a sin. So this is very clear as well, that Nuh is said, is told in the Quran that he did something he should not have done. Likewise, Dawood alayhi salam, will come to his story when we come to it, that Dawood alayhi salam did something that he should not have done. فَاسْتَغْفَرَ رَبَّهُ وَخَرَّ رَاكِعًا وَأَنَابَ So he asked Allah to forgive him and he fell down in prostration and in repentance. فَغَفَرْنَا لَهُ ذَلِكَ We forgave him what he had done. The notion of what he had done, we're going to talk about this a lot more. There's a lot of interpretation. Now is not the time to get into all of that. The point is that it is very clear. Dawood istaghfar, which means he had done something he shouldn't have done. And Allah says, فَغَفَرْنَا We forgave. So Dawood committed a sin. Likewise, the son of Dawood, Sulaiman alayhi salam, there's also the story, we're going to come to it as well, of him doing something he should not have done and falling into a state of ghafla. And so he as well asked Allah to forgive him. And we're going to get to it when we get to it. And of course, Yunus alayhi salam, very explicit that he did something he should not have done. The prophets, they are commissioned by Allah. There is no resigning from being a prophet. You can't just give up and quit. You don't do that. You know, once your job is commissioned by Allah, you have to be non-stop. You don't just say, okay, I resign and I turn my back to my chores. But Yunus alayhi salam, before he was given permission to leave his people, he got so angry at the arrogance of his people that he simply turned his back and walked away from his people. And he should not have done that. The prophets cannot just do that. And so Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in the Quran, فَظَنَّ أَلَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ He thought we would not punish him. He thought we would not hold him accountable. He thought we would not hold him accountable. But Allah did hold him accountable. And so Allah Azza wa Jal caused him to go into the whale, the belly of the whale. And وَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ Yunus acknowledges, I am from the wrongdoers. I did wrong. He calls himself of the ظَالِمِينَ and he asks Allah to forgive him. And so Allah forgave him. And once again, we can sympathize with Yunus because the arrogance of his people, just the hard-headedness of his people. So Yunus just gave up and he just got frustrated out of just not being able to deal with the arrogance. So again, we can sympathize, you know, with that. So by the way, the story of Musa, I mentioned it, was it last week or the class that we did in the previous class? We cannot use the story of Musa and him punching the Israelite because this happened before he became a prophet. And we're talking about what happens after you become a prophet. Musa alayhi salam, not the Israelite, punching the Egyptian, the Copt, that Musa became angry and he overreacted and he caused a death. And this is a huge problem. It is involuntary manslaughter. It's not a trivial thing. But this occurred before he was a prophet. So it doesn't come into our list over here. As for our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are generic verses and a hadith that mention Allah's forgiveness on him. So in the Quran, لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ So that Allah can forgive your sins, what you have done and what you are going to do. So Allah Azza wa Jal wants to forgive the sins. Allah calls it a dhanb, a sin. And He Himself said, إِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ I ask Allah's forgiveness more than 100 times a day. And in the long hadith of the intercession of Shafa'a that I've done in multiple lectures and classes, where every single prophet will say, Nafsi, Nafsi, I'm worried about myself, I'm worried about myself. each one of them will mention something that is troubling him. So this shows us that the prophets can commit infractions and sins. What is the wisdom behind the prophets committing sins? Why would Allah Azza wa Jalla allow them to do so? Well, a number of things that have been mentioned about wisdoms. First and foremost, so that they recognize that they're not perfect, and in that recognition, they renew their efforts to try to become even more perfect or even better. And the story of Musa is classic over here, even though it happened before he became a prophet, but the philosophy or the paradigm that when he killed the Coptic, when he killed the Egyptian, what did Musa say? قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي ظَلَمْتُ نَفْسِي he said, oh Allah, I have wronged myself. And then he says, because of this, لَنْ أَكُونَ ظَهِيرًا لِلْمُجْرِمِينَ I'm never going to support a wrongdoer. I have realized I did something I shouldn't have done. So from now on, I am never going to be on the side of injustice. I'm always going to be on the side of justice. لَنْ أَكُونَ ظَهِيرًا لِلْمُجْرِمِينَ So Musa alayhi salam, his mistake caused him to be a better person. And that's one of the wisdoms of the prophets committing these types of mistakes or slip-ups. Also of the wisdoms is that Allah Azza wa Jal loves those who repent. And so if Allah wants to love the prophets even more, their repentance should be the best repentance. And it is said in our literature that the repentance of Adam alayhi salam was legendary, that hardly anybody repented, you know, as sincerely in the history of mankind as our father Adam, that when he came down to earth, you know, the grief overwhelmed him and the crying and the repentance lasted for many years or decades. And of course, throughout his life, he continued to make amends for that. And so Allah loves those who repent, and therefore, if the prophets are the most beloved to Allah, then they must also be beloved because they repent. Because it is those who repent and turn back to Allah who achieve the highest level of Allah's mahabba. And Allah wants to show He is the Rahman and the Rahim and the Ghafoor and the Afu and the Kareem. And He wants to show these names to the prophets that He loves. So how can Allah show He is the Arhamur Rahimeen and the Rahman and the Khairur Rahimeen and the Ghafoor and the Ghaffar and the Ghafir, and Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who is Afu to His chosen prophets except by though allowing them to commit these minor sins and then having them repent and then showering them with His divine majesty and mercy and forgiveness. And so Allah allows this type of sins to occur so that He can then shower the prophets with His mercy and forgiveness. Also, of the wisdoms that are mentioned in this regard is that because the prophets must be role models, and if the prophets became angels, there is no connection between us and them. If the prophets were not human, and this is mentioned in the Quran, that if we sent down an angel, وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ مَلَكًا, if we sent down an angel, he would have to look like a human. And we'd have to make him dress like a human. And then you'd end up rejecting him anyway. And if there was an angel, you would basically not have a connection. You would say, how can we be expected to be like the angels? However, when you have a prophet whom you can see is flesh and blood, and you see from this prophet the same struggles that we all have, Adam alayhi salam and Nuh alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam, the same struggles of, you know, wanting to live a better life or loving your children or whatnot. And sometimes these struggles cause a slip up, a minor issue, a one-off infraction, and they turn back to Allah. And so we have a connection with the prophets. And you know, if you listen to my, you know, I have a long series of the seerah, over 100 lectures, as most of you are aware. And this was the paradigm that I had in that series. And anytime one of these types of incidents occurred, I kept on saying that for me, this is actually something that allows me to love and respect and admire and take the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as a role model, because we see the perfection, whatever it might have been. Listen to the seerah, I have multiple incidents in there, that when these types of things happen, you know, far from a'udhu billah, you know, denigrating a'udhu billah, on the contrary, our respect and our love and our admiration grows, and we find a role model that we can actually relate to because he is flesh and blood, because he is a human being. And so they become perfect role models, not because they are perfect, but because they strive for perfection. It is in those minor imperfections, and then they're overcoming those minor imperfections, that they become perfect role models. Otherwise, if they were 100% flawless, how can we take them as a connection and a role model? And so this is another reason why the prophets have these minor infractions or sins. And again, these are all minor sins in the sense that, you know, the major sins are, you know, like riba or like, you know, murder or like a'udhu billah zina. These are the major sins. None of the prophets can ever be guilty of those major sins after the coming of the revelation. But, you know, minor sins are other than this, one-off. Yes, it has been narrated in the Quran and in the Sunnah from the prophets. Now, this is the position, as I said, of many, many scholars. Now, each of these two groups says we have the majority on our side. And if you want my brutally honest opinion, we cannot decide the majority. And the majority actually doesn't really matter in this regard because of circumstances. You can listen to one of the library chats I gave you, find it online, about Ismail and Ishaq alayhimus salam, and listen to that and you'll understand why the mere existence of which side is a majority doesn't mean the opinion is right or wrong. What is more significant to us is that we have erudite, respectable names on both sides of this controversy. The side that I've just advocated, which is that the prophets can commit one-off minor sins if those sins are not denigrating in nature to the status or to the respect of the prophets, and they repent and they become role models in their repentance. This is the position of many, many, many great ulama. And I'll mention some of them very quickly because again, the problem comes that each strand or each group wishes to claim these days, because there is sectarianism that is unhealthy, that they are the only correct group even within Sunnism. And this is simply not the case. It is possible that there are multiple positives in all of the groups out there, and we respect all of these groups. So one of the great scholars, Ibn Battal, died 449. That he mentions that the scholars have differed, that is it possible for the prophets to commit sins? And he says there is unanimous consensus that they cannot commit any mistakes in conveying the message, and that they cannot commit any major sins. However, there is difference of opinion, can minor sins occur from them? And so he says the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij, they said that it is not permissible for them to commit minor sins, and it is impossible for them to do anything of this nature. And then he says that other scholars of Sunni Islam, they said that they can commit minor sins. Ibn Abdul Barr, the famous Maliki scholar from Andalusia, died 463. Ibn Abdul Barr said that the prophets cannot commit any type of major sin. However, the sagair are possible, and they are ma'sumun min al-kaba'ir, and they are protected from committing major sins. So Ibn Abdul Barr says that it is ja'iz for sagair to occur. The famous Al-Qadhi Iyad, another great Maliki scholar from Andalusia, died 554. He wrote one of the most famous books about the blessings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ash-Shifa. It has been translated to English as well. Al-Qadhi Iyad says, وَأَمَّا الصَّغَائِرْ فَجَوَّزَهَا جَمَاعَةٌ مِنَ السَّلَفِ وَغَيْرِهِمْ عَلَى الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَهُوَ مَذْهَبُ الطَّبَرِي وَغَيْرُهُ مِنَ الْفُقَهَاءِ وَالْمُحَدِّثِينَ وَالْمُتَكَلِّمِينَ. As for committing minor sins, then a group of the scholars of the Salaf said that this is something that the prophets are can happen to the prophets, and it is the position of Imam al-Tabari and many of, or some of the fuqaha and the scholars of hadith and the scholars of theology. And so he affirms this is the position of many people, and then he himself basically says, but I don't think this is the correct opinion. So he says it is there, but he respectfully then posits his own. The famous Ash'ari scholar Al-Amidi also has something similar. And Nawawi, the scholar of Hadith at 676, also says the exact same things, that اختلفوا في وقوع غيرها من الصغائر فذهب معظم الفقهاء والمحدثين والمتكلمين من السلف والخلف إلى جواز وقوعها منهم. So Al-Nawawi says, and I want those people who think that, you know, this opinion is batil and it is something that is by only one, they call it a fanatical strand or a literalist stand. This is Imam al-Nawawi, and you know who Nawawi is. And Nawawi said that the mu'azam, or the majority of fuqaha, scholars of fiqh, and muhaddithin, scholars of hadith, and mutakallimin, scholars of kalam and theology, from the salaf and the khalaf, they said that it is possible for the prophets to commit minor sins. And this is also the position of Imam al-Dhahabi and Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim and generally speaking, the scholars of the Hanabila and the Athari strand of Sunnism. This is the position that they hold. And you'll find many, many quotes in this regard. Now on the other side, you have famous scholars within the Ash'ari and some of the Maturidi schools, but especially with the Ash'ari school, and of course many of the scholars of Tasawwuf as well, that they felt that it is not befitting to say that the prophets commit any sins whatsoever. And amongst this group of people are people like Fakhruddin al-Razi, people like As-Subki, even Ibn Hajar, for example. He says that yes, some it has been narrated that the position exists that minor sins occur. However, the correct opinion is that even minor sins they cannot do. And so this group basically they negate the fact that prophets can commit minor sins. Now, what do they do with this mountain of evidences that we have presented? The story of Adam being open shut case and Yunus alayhi salam and others. I mean, these are explicit evidences. What do they do? Well, if you read their explanations, their commentaries, their works of tafsir and whatnot, they have to basically work around and rephrase. And in Arabic, and even in Urdu we say this, but in Arabic you call this takalluf. And takalluf means making the that which is self-evident, you kind of make it more complicated in order to try to find the position that you want. You make the simple complicated. Maybe that's the best way to call it, takalluf. And this is what they are forced to do with our utmost love and respect to them. And of the things that they attempt to do is change the wordings. They say, oh, this isn't a them, this isn't a sin, rather it is a slip up, a khata, a mistake. And because the maqam of the prophets is so high, a mistake from them, you might as well call it a sin. And so they say it's not literal when Allah says he committed a sin. It's basically being extra harsh because the maqam of the prophets indicates that even a slip up from them should be extra harsh. And so, they call it a sahu or a khata. It's something that is a mistake. Let's not call it a sin. And so again, that's their interpretation. And of course they bring a mountain of evidence about another topic, which is the status of the prophets. And they say, how, this is an emotional argument, how could the prophets commit these minor sins when Allah has described them as being the best of the best, and Allah has istafakum, and Allah Azza wa Jal has said you are the rahmata lil alameen, and Allah has said that you are a qudwa, and Allah has said that laqad kana fi rasulillahi uswatun hasana. So they bring all of these verses, which nobody disagrees about, and these verses talk about the status of the prophets. And then they extrapolate an argument that is not academic, it's more emotional. And they will say, based on this status, how can you then say that they committed a sin? And the response is, their status is there, and these slip-ups are there, and we combine the two together, and there's no contradiction whatsoever. They are the best of the best, and they are the qudwa, and they are the uswa, and they are the rahmatul alameen. And there are these one-off incidences that sometimes occurs with the prophets, and these are minor sins in the end of the day. And Allah Azza wa Jal forgives them, and Allah loves them. And in these infractions, we find a role model in them, in how we should commit tawbah and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the other opinion out there, and it is the position of, I would say in our times, the majority of the Ash'ari school. For the advanced students, the Ash'ari school clearly has some tensions within it over this issue, and you find some of them, especially their earlier ones, having an opinion, and then their later ones having another opinion, even though you find both opinions in the past and the present. But it is quite clear, and you can look up, as I said, Ibn Battal and An-Nawawi and others of that school who clearly had positions. However, Fakhruddin al-Razi, who is one of their great muhaqqiqeen, he has a treatise called Ismatul Anbiya, and in his tafsir he is very clear. He does not want to call anything the prophets have done a sin, and he negates the concept of sins coming from the prophets, and he has his methodology for doing so. And this position has also been adopted by most of the people of the Tasawwuf strand of Islam. And I have spoken about Tasawwuf, that Sufism is not a theological school. It is difficult to generalize and say all. In fact, it is impossible. You really cannot say the people of Sufism because it's too broad and there's too many strands. Nonetheless, majority of those who ascribe to the Tasawwuf, not that there's anything wrong with it, I've spoken about this in other lectures, but just factually speaking, obviously their notions of the prophethood preclude them from ever saying that the prophets can commit sins. Now, again, a bit of an advanced footnote here. One's position about the ismah of the prophets also affects other issues of theology, and especially how you view the role of the prophets, the spiritual status of the prophets, your own relationship with the prophets in this stage now, going to the prophets, asking of their needs, going through them, the wasila. So all of this is, you know, there is some linkage of how you view this versus how you view that. Nonetheless, it's not a strong linkage, but nonetheless it is there. And this is a subject that is covered in the advanced treatises on Islamic theology, and quite a lot of dissertations and articles have been written, and one can go back and forth. Now, this is the position within Sunni Islam. These are the two main positions. Just for the record, non-Sunni, the largest non-Sunni group, and I mean by this the 12 imamis, the ayatollahs in the lands of Iran and whatnot, that their strand of Islam, they also say that the prophets are absolutely sinless. And they also then go a little bit further and they say that anybody who claims otherwise has disrespected the prophets, and some have even said that it is a type of kufr to go to that level. And of course, their reasons for doing so are very different. And they also believe that their imams are also ma'soom, protected. So it's not just the prophets who are protected, but they say that their imams are also protected. And of course, from our perspective, that is simply not the case, but that is their interpretation. So to conclude, there is a marked difference, first and foremost, between the biblical narrative and the Quranic narrative. And that's where we can, alhamdulillah, breathe a sigh of relief. The Quran is absolutely free of ascribing any sin that is detestable or disgusting or bizarre or major to the prophets. The Quran is very clear. The prophets are not guilty of such major sins. Rather, what one finds are one-off slip-ups, non-repetitive disobediences, things they should not have done, that are all linked to human emotions that we can sympathize with. All of them are linked to human emotions that run in all of humanity. We can empathize with them. Adam alayhi salam wanted to live. Yunus alayhi salam became frustrated with a group of people that were arrogant. Nuh alayhi salam loved his son and requested Allah azza wa jal to save him, and so on and so forth. And in all of these incidents, they repented immediately. They did not persist in their sin. And their repentance becomes a role model for us. This is the position that I have advocated. Nonetheless, because in all of these cases, there is such human emotions involved, you have another strand of Islam saying that we don't call these sins, rather we call them honest mistakes. We call them khata or sahu or slip-ups, and we don't call it a sin because of the status of the prophets. And so when we find the word sin or whatnot, it is somewhat metaphorical language that Allah Azza wa Jalla is using, because their status indicates that they shouldn't even have done this. Nonetheless, this controversy at some point really becomes technical or linguistic, because in the end of the day, all of Sunni Islam acknowledges that the prophets are as perfect as possible, and that the prophets are role models, and that the prophets are worthy of emulation, and that the goal of all of these stories is to raise the status of the prophets, and not like the biblical narrative, which is, a'udhu billah, denigrating the status of the prophets. And with that, inshallah ta'ala, we come to the conclusion of this week's lecture on the prophets. And inshallah ta'ala, we will continue with inshallah ta'ala next week. Until then, jazakumullahu khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
يا من أجبت دعاء نوح فانتصر وحملته في فلكك المشحون يا من أحال النار حول خليله روحا وريحانا بقولك كون